Hi guys, hope you're well. In this video, I'll talk about a book titled The Black Mountain, an interdisciplinary experiment, 1933-1957.
It was published by Spector Books in Leipzig, Germany, on the occasion of a special exhibition at the Nationalgalerie in Hamburger Bahnhof in Berlin. And it was edited by Eugen Blume, Matilda Felix, Gabriele Knapstein and Katrine Nichols. The book has 464 pages and it was designed by Daniel Haufe and Detlef Fiedler from SIAM in Berlin. It has sections on binding and plastic orange dust jacket, and it was printed in Germany by DZA. John Andrew Rice, a professor at Rollins College in Winter Park, Florida, was dismissed from his post in April 1933 for criticizing the teaching methods used at the college. Together with colleagues and sympathetic students, he founded Black Mountain College in the fall of 1933. 12 teachers and 22 students began lessons in mid-September in the rented Robert Lee Hall near Asheville, North Carolina, under new self-imposed conditions. Rice explained the principles of the college as follows. Our central and consistent effort is to teach method, not content. To emphasize process, not results. To invite the student to the realization that the way of handling facts is more important than the facts themselves. The big family and the village are gone, but mankind needs them, especially the village. Only it must no longer be haphazard, a product of chance, but the best possible village that can be created, free of the old village narrowness, malice, cruelty, and obscurantism. And we here in Black Mountain have stumbled on the idea that the college must be this new village. It must have also some of the characteristics of the big family. Beginnings are usually more interesting than elaborations and endings. Beginning means exploration, selection, development, a potent vitality not yet limited, not circumscribed by the tried and traditional. When the letter arrived from America inviting Joseph Albers to Black Mountain College, the Bauhaus artist and teacher and his young wife Annie welcomed the opportunity to escape an increasingly untenable political situation and deteriorating prospects for modernist artists in Germany, and to make a fresh start in a new and promising environment. The founders of Black Mountain College could not have imagined in 1933 the extent to which the college would come to rely on and be enriched by the contribution of a succession of emigres from the European catastrophe, or to the extent to which the events set in motion by German politics would transform the cultural and educational agendas of the United States. The stories of these emigres fit neatly into the larger narrative of the flight of assimilated, secular, educated Jews and anti-fascists from the discriminatory and ultimately deadly grasp of National Socialist Germany, a cultivated and civilized society undone by nationalist forces and economic vicissitudes. They were artists and musicians, mathematicians, scholars, philosophers and scientists, cut loose suddenly and often violently from their generally prosperous and urbane intellectual moorings and grateful to find a home, however unpolished, in a new world. Together they represent a microcosm of the much greater story of European transplants in the United States in the 1930s and 1940s. What emerges is their collective drive to put aside loss and nostalgia and to move forward, to adapt and embrace what was, to put it blandly, their only hope of survival. Among them were mathematician Max Dehn, psychoanalyst Fritz Mallenhoff, psychiatrist and philosopher Erwin Strauss, physicist Peter Bergmann, conductor and musicologist Heinrich Jalowitz, and dancer Elsa Kahl. They taught the young students about the modern scientific and artistic ideas that had been vigorously promoted in Europe until the totalitarian regimes had assumed power there. Many of the students also came from emigre families, including the prospective composer Ursula Mamlock and the dancer Viola Farber, both of whom had become aware of the outstanding opportunities offered by the college. All members of the college lived on campus with their families, and the college was open to both sexes from its first year, which at the time in America was clearly the exception rather than the rule. The Black Mountain way of life is a way of endless activity scheduled morning, afternoon, and evening, weekday and weekend. Instead of sports, there is farm work, maintenance work, building, typing, entertaining. These things go on every afternoon, and in the evenings a steady stream of lectures, concerts and meetings takes place. The meals in the dining room were another aspect of communal life that all kinds of personalities regarded as essential for the specific atmosphere of appreciative education and creativity. As John Cage explained, what I think was so important at Black Mountain was that we all ate our meals together. For instance, I was teaching music composition, but no one was studying with me. I had no students, but I would sit at a table three times a day and there would be conversations, and those meals were the classes, and ideas would come out. Black Mountain College was based on the ethos that art, in conjunction with the humanities and sciences, played a pivotal role in the free development of personality. There was no predetermined curriculum, but students were encouraged to attend courses in various scientific and artistic disciplines, and also to undertake manual labor. In order to secure the long-term prospects of the college, which was initially accommodated in rented premises, a lakeside property north of the Black Mountain district was purchased. Walter Gropius and Marcel Breuer had initially presented a design for a model building with three wings, but this could not be built for financial reasons. Instead, a studies building designed by architect and Black Mountain lecturer Lawrence Kocher was built in 1940-41. The building was constructed mainly by faculty and students to keep the cost down. Other houses and classrooms were built on the campus at Lake Eden within the framework of architecture classes and workshops conceived for that purpose. Financial concerns were the main driving force that compelled Black Mountain College to initiate a major construction project under its own direction. The fact that this option was even considered was a consequence of the college's progressive approach to education. The college's own construction project effectively served as a miniature model for social structures for which it was supposed to also prepare the students. It was intended to increase their understanding of socially necessary work and help them adopt responsible roles. The students increased to some degree their understanding of society, gain more respect for skilled workmanship, and adopt a less superficial and more sympathetic attitude toward necessary hard work and toward those who perform it. We are finally on our own grounds. What we should carry on, I think, is our belief that behavior and social adjustment are as interesting and important as knowledge, said Albers in 1941. John Cage wrote, "At Black Mountain College in 1952, I organized an event that involved the paintings of Bob Rauschenberg, dancing of Merce Cunningham, films, slides, phonograph records, radios, the poetries of Charles Alton and M.C. Richards recited from the top of ladders, and the pianism of David Tudor, together with my Juilliard lecture, which ends, a piece of string, a sunset, each axe." With the appointment of Charles Alton as rector in 1953, the role of literature became more important, and the college became the focal point of the Black Mountain poets. Music took on an increasingly experimental character due to the presence of Lou Harrison and Stephen Volpe, as well as lecturers John Cage and David Tudor. In the 1950s, the realm of the visual arts and crafts was further expanded to include a pottery workshop and crafts institutes. The formal closure of the college in 1957 was accompanied by a long phase of liquidation and the sale of property and other assets. Teachers and students scattered in all directions and formed creative groups that continued working in the spirit of Black Mountain. This not only shaped the further development of art, but also of universities, opening them up to alternative models of liberal education. M.C. Richards wrote, "Black Mountain College was born in controversy and died in controversy. Splendid in the between, as she inspired and shattered dreams of liberation and fulfillment."
In my opinion, it's a very smart book. The way the content is organized and designed allows for very different readings. You can go through the book very quickly and just read the quotes.
If we have a bit more time, we can also read the short synopsis of each essays or directly the essays. Finally, we can take our time and read the archival materials. Otherwise, we could avoid the text altogether and just look at the images. In any case, it's a very nice experience. The readers get to know some of the content at their own pace and they get to choose how much time they want to spend on the book.
Check it out at your local bookstore. I hope this video was useful. Thank you very much for watching and see you in the next one. Bye!